Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word. Heavenly Father, on this wonderful and beautiful day, I lift up all of the fathers here. I lift up Pastor Izzy as you prepare him to deliver your message today. A wonderful group of folks here that are here to hear your words, Lord, to hear it as you intend to have it touch them, Lord, as you would have it touch them. So on this very busy day, I just ask, Lord, that you clear our hearts, clear our minds, Lord. Just let us settle in, relax, and hear your word.
Yes,
Lord, these things we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, guys. Would you grab your Bibles? If you don't have one, raise your hand. We'll get some of the guys to run around. Holland, could you grab a couple of those, and he'll bring one to you. We're in 1 John chapter 5. We're going to finish up this little epistle this morning. As last week, we did just three verses, but three of my favorite verses. They were the verses that I told you, if you ever prayed and, you know, not really had it, felt like you got an answer. Anyone ever done that? I mean, I don't want to make you seem unspiritual, but anyone here prayed about something and felt like no answer was coming, and you're wondering, what is up? Well, last week we went over verses 13 through 15, where I shared the message, what John the Apostle said he learned from the Lord. He actually gives this secret. If you want to get your prayers answered, 100% guaranteed, the answer was found in last week's study. And Dylan, is it up on YouTube yet? Yes? No? He's looking at me. I don't know. Yes? Okay, it is. So last week's is up on YouTube. And if you really, you know, that's a topic that a lot of people struggle with. You know, they pray about stuff. Some people are like, how come you get answers and I don't? And, you know, another person next to them is getting answers and they're still going, I get them once in a while and not all the time. And I shared with you the secret, right, last week. Did anyone do this secret, by the way, during your week that we went over? Does anyone remember what the secret was? What's the secret to make sure you get your prayers, well, first of all, heard? You have to get them heard by God, right? The whole thing is, if you get him to hear your prayers, it says, then you know you have what? The answer. Because he's a God that acts upon those things which he hears. But there are some things what we're asking. It says that, well, we went over this last week, but just to recap, because it doesn't make sense to go into the next part if you don't keep this in mind. The next part of this chapter is just the continuation of this thought. But I got to kind of frame it in the context that it's given in. When we pray according to his what? Will. Then it says he hears us. And when he hears us, it tells us that we know we have the things which we have asked. Because, you know, I use the example of the kid in my youth group that asked me to teach him how to build a bomb. And it wasn't that I, you know, having the knowledge of how to build a bomb, it can be helpful if you live on a farm and you need to blow a stump out of the ground, okay? But he wasn't asking me for how to do something practical like that. You know why he wanted to learn how to build a bomb? Do you remember? He wanted to use that knowledge to blow up some kids who had hurt his feelings. And he's like, you learned that in Scouts. Could you teach me how to make a bomb? And what chemicals do I mix? And I said, before I teach you how to make a bomb, maybe I got to teach him how to forgive. You know, be like a better lesson to learn first. Because, you know, I don't really think I should teach you. Have you ever felt like that when someone's, you know, maybe kids are asking for a certain, Mommy, can I have a knife? Why? I want to go cut that guy. No, you may not have a knife. I mean, sometimes we're asking things which, you know, as a good earthly parent, we're like, I ain't giving you that kid because it's going to hurt them. Or they're going to use it to hurt someone else. And some of our prayers, whether we understand it or not, we're actually praying for things which might come to hurt us. I mean, as our Heavenly Father sees us, he goes, no, I'm not giving you that. That could hurt you. Or that might cause you to hurt someone else. You know, some people have said to me, well, you know, I prayed that God would make me rich because I'm tired of being poor. I mean, every day I got to go back to God and Dear God, give us this day our daily what? Our daily bread. Yeah, our daily mammon, our rich. I need enough to get through the day. I'm back. And they talk to me like this is a bad thing. You know, if you go to God every day and ask for your daily portion, what you need, does he supply what we need? He's faithful. And he proves and reproves his faithfulness to us every single day. If it was intended that we would pray, give us this day our annual bread. Lord, give me enough bread to cover me for the whole year. I won't bug you for another year. I'll be back. See you in a year. Do you think that's what our Heavenly Father desires? A relationship where we check in once a year? What would we do with all that bread? I mean, we might go, yeah, I got enough for a year, but then, you know, something might come up and we might just kind of blow half the year on one day, and it might just, you know, or we might make decisions that we wouldn't otherwise make because we don't even need to check in with God if I can afford this. I know I can afford it. I got it already, right? Has anybody ever bought something on impulse and you had the money, so you did it, and then later you went, why did I do that? I mean, or the thing just, what is it with the new stuff? My kids, they kind of crack up because I grew up in a generation where we were fortunate. Engineers were told to design stuff to last when I was young. You know, when they designed a toaster in the 50s and 60s, those toasters, what's funny is they still work today. But the toaster, what you get from Walmart right now, I guarantee if it says 2-year warranty, that at 2 years in about one day, right, it's gone. The thing, they put a little chip in there. This thing will last till 2 years in one day, and then it's going to fry the circuit, and the thing will no longer work. And the old stuff, which didn't have a circuit, if something went wrong, you open it up, you clean up a few contacts, tighten up a few screws, plug it back in, it works. Still works. And we have a 1941 gas stove. That thing, now lately the thermostat wire came off the back wall, so it's not giving me a correct reading. I got to figure out a way to make a little bracket to put it back in. But what's that?
So it shoots up to 500
and back. And needs a little dialing back in. But until that bracket broke, that thing is a I mean, I look at the new stuff, and I'm like, why would you want that? You can't fix it. You can't service it. They built it to. Does anyone else get frustrated besides me that they build it to break?
Yeah.
You know, they build in this obsolescence, and I just go, oh, it's not right. This is not how it's supposed to be. But sometimes, when I have the little bit of extra money and that impulse buy comes, I forget to do a simple thing. Pray and say, God, do I need this? Or should I get this? You know, sometimes if I would just do that, I could save myself the headache of the disappointment that will come when the obsolescence rolls around. Because I'll buy it on impulse and get it home, play with it a little bit, and all of a sudden, poof, it broke. Man! And then disappointment comes, and the Lord's like, you didn't ask me to start with. And I'm like, oh, yeah. And I remember last week I said, would you just try this for me? If anyone wants some prayers answered this week, just go to God and say, God, here's my petition. Whatever you want to pray about. It doesn't matter what the topic is. You can talk to God about anything. But remember to ask for whose will? Like Jesus said, not my will, but your will be done, right? Thy will be done. When you pray for his will, even though you might not understand, he might say no to some things because he's got something better for you. Nope, I don't want you to take that, Jimmy. I got something better. He's not being mean. It's because he's looking out, just like we do for our children down here. Sometimes no is the appropriate answer. Now, we don't like that answer, especially American Christians. They're the most spoiled in the world. The rest of the world, if you preach this message, they'd be like, we already know this, Pastor. Get on to something else. You know, God's allowed to say no. He's God. We get that. Christians in America are like, I don't think he should say no. I think I should get my way all the time. What's the secret to getting my way all the time? I'm like, you're like a spoiled brat, spiritually. Spiritual brat. Me, 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 I want my way. I'm not getting my way. How many Yeah, you can force the issue and get your way. But later when something goes wrong, you'll be like, why did I do that? And I just want to spare you that whole roller coaster ride. Just come to what John said here. Just ask God. And if you can receive this, how many of you think God knows better than we do? Just curiosity. Like, does he really know what's best? And does he look out for us? Because, see, if you don't think God loves you and that he's looking out for you, you're going to have a hard time praying to him for his will, because you're going to think he's mean and going to do something bad to you. He's not. He may say no to some things because he's protecting you from whatever consequence that might lead to in your life. But it's not because he's mean. It's because he loves you. And he's protecting you. Now, John said you can talk to him and ask for his will in anything. And if you pray according to his will, you know that he hears you. Now, remember, John, at this time, when he's writing 1 John, he's been pastoring for some time by this point. You know, the book of 1 John is, he wrote this, what's the date on this one? Around 60-something? 60? I'm going out of my old Bible. It's not written in this one. Anyone have a note what says what you know, approximately the year he wrote 1 John? Some Bibles have them right at the top of your, of the intro page. Does anyone have it in theirs? What's your say? It'll be an approximation. They don't know the exact dates on all the books, but they know 80s or early 90s. That sounds so 80. Let's just say in 80 to 90 AD. Jesus died at what time? We just went over this with the kids last night at the College and Career. When did Jesus die? 33 AD, right? He went into his public ministry when he was 30, ministered in the public life for 3 years, and then was crucified, buried, and rose again. 33 AD, the resurrection takes place. So this is going to be, let's just say it's 80, I'm going to do easy math, 83 AD. It's between 80 and 90, so I'm going to do this. If it's 33 AD Jesus died, and it's 83 when John's writing this letter, how many decades have passed? 50 years have gone by. In 50 years' time, do you think John ever ran into a few Christians wanting to know why their prayers weren't getting answered? Do you think he ever had to face the people like, I just don't get an answer, Pastor? And I know I've had those seasons too, until I learned this verse. Once I learned this verse, I quit wasting time on praying what I call prayers that didn't get answered and shifted to more effective praying. I don't know about you, but I'm just one of those guys. If I'm going to do it, I want it to work. I hate doing something and then having it not, be effective. So I'm like, okay, you say, just ask according to your will, then I know you hear us. Verse 15, and if we know you hear us, then in whatever we ask, then we know we have the things, the very request which we have asked from you. Works for me. Now on, God, I just pray, here's my petition, here's my request, but not my will, but whose will? Your will be done. And because this little truth has leapt off the page and went not just into my mind, but I call it some people call this the 6 or 8 inch journey from the here to here, drop down to the heart. Once it gets in your heart where you realize, he's looking out for me. I want to ask for his will. God, here's what I want, but not my will, but your will be done. Here's my petition. You know, Lord, I need a vehicle to get back and forth to work. And I could be spying out that one looks good. And the Lord knows that one's a lemon under the hood. You don't want that one. You can have one like that one, not that one. Okay? That one needs a whole new motor. Transmission's about to go. I've got one over here. Now, if you're willing to say, God, not my will, but your will be done, does he mind directing you away from that one and to the one that will work? Does God go, oh, this is going to be really hard? How many of you think it's hard for God to direct us? You know, each of us individually. Can he, like, just speak to our heart where we don't have anyone else around? And he'll go, nope. Has anyone ever felt this, like, I call it like some people use this word check. A check in their spirit. They were about to do something, and then something like almost like a, hey, stop. Like a little red alert. I guess I watched too much Lost in Space and Star Trek and stuff. But will Danger Will Robinson, Danger, you know, the little robot? That's what sometimes I feel like God says to me when I'm going the wrong way. Danger, danger, stop. Now, if he's saying, has anyone ever been doing something and just all out of the blue you felt this, stop. There's no one else. And I'm not saying there could be people around, but you know you're to stop. What'd you do? Did you stop? I mean, sometimes, we don't want to admit it, sometimes we don't stop, and then we proceed and pay the price. But how many of you have stopped and looking back just at those times when you did listen, you got to see with hindsight how God just kept you from making a really doozy of a mistake? Because you just, the Bible says that God speaks to us with his spirit. It's a still, small voice. You know, in Psalm 46, verse 10, it comes across from Hebrew, but it's to be still, be calm, like cease striving. Don't strive, don't try. You know when you try to make something happen, that's striving. He says, stop it. Stop striving. Just calm yourself. Stop. Quit fighting. Be still and know that I am God. He says in verse 10 of Psalm 46, you will know that God is real when you quit fighting and you just say, let me walk in your will. And there's something that happens wonderfully to us when we do this. It brings a peace over us that we can't. The Bible says it's a peace that it surpasses all human comprehension. You can't figure out why it is, but you just feel, wow, that was good. If you continue to strive, though, you continue to force it to happen, what happens to that peace? It's gone, isn't it? Poof. It just disappeared. I have no peace. Pastor, I got to talk to you. What's the matter? I don't have any peace today. What are you doing that you felt you... No, I don't lead in with this, but I like to sometimes. What are you doing that you should have not done? Eventually, I got to get to that point. So what's happening, brother? Lord been speaking to you about anything? Yeah, I felt like you told me to stop and help that person. And I'm calling you. And I'm like, what, to tell me what happened? Did you stop and help him? Oh, no, I didn't stop. But maybe you could go over there on the side of the road down by. You know, when we don't do what the Spirit is leading us to do, it's weird how we call the pastor to get him to go do it. Now, you guys chuckle, but I know because I've spoke to a few of you. And you come and you tell, and I'm like thinking, no. When you feel that leading of his Spirit to say, go help that person or stop. I don't want you to go that way. I'm just, and you proceed anyway. Your peace, that peace of God that he grants to us, it leaves. And that's one of the things that when people say, why do this Christian walk? I said, because you don't understand. You know, how good is the peace of God for our hearts? How good is it for our body, you know, like our overall body? When you feel that peace of God come on you, it's like, it's better than money, I think, because money, you can have money, but not peace. And money can't buy the peace. If it could, then I'd say, go get money so you can buy the peace. But is it really possible to buy that kind of peace from God? No, it's not something for sale. It's something that we get gifted from him when we simply stop fighting against him, stop striving, like Psalm 46 says, and we just be still. We still ourselves and say, hey. And when it says be still, it's saying, hold on. Let God work. Be still and know that I am God. Like, let me have a little room here. I'll fix it. If you just give me a little room to work. You know, sometimes we don't give God any wiggle room to do anything. God, we got a problem down here. And I'm going to help you up because, look, you're a little slow today. So let's get this fixed. And I don't know, maybe it's just a man thing. We like to fix problems, right? The girls like to talk about it. The guys like to fix it. But I don't care if you're talking about it or you're trying to fix it. Inside, there's a turmoil that happens when you don't yield it over to God. To let him be part of the solution. Let him direct the answer. And this is the part John is leading into. He's saying, guys, been doing this for like 50 years now. 50 years talking to people about Jesus, and he was there with Jesus, okay? So this is a seasoned guy. This is, you know, if you got a pastor who's 50 years in the ministry, would you think, who by the way, leaned on Jesus's, right at the Last Supper, where he was the guy leaning on the Lord? When you say, how close were you to the Lord? Well, you know, like this. You know, I mean, you can't knock his credentials. He was right there. He saw the Lord crucified. He was the one at the bottom of the cross, the foot of the cross. When Jesus was hanging there, Jesus looked from the cross. One of his final words he spoke before he yielded up his spirit was he looked down and he saw his mother, Jesus' mother Mary. And what did he say? John, behold your mother. Mom, behold your son. What was he saying? This makes sense if you're raised Italian, because he's entrusting his mom. Yeah, it's his friend. John, look after my mom. Mom, there's your Hanai son. That's a Hawaiian term, your adopted boy. And he took, even on the cross, Jesus took care of his mother. Mom, son, mom. You say, how close was John to Jesus? Close. To be entrusted to his mother. Very close. 50 years of ministry now. Pastor. We had a pastor pastored 50 years. Would anyone here think, that's a good guy to go talk to about a problem? Because he's, I don't know about you, but I like the seasoned guys. I appreciate the zeal of the young new guys, but they don't always have an answer. And they don't have that wisdom. You know, there's something that happens with that age and that those years of experience that gives them the, you know, where they cut through all the little foofy stuff and get to the answer. I don't know about you, but I'm a straightforward. I like straight to the answer. Give me the point. That's what I want. John is giving us the whole point. He said, look at this. Verse 13, he said, these things I write to you. I've written them to you who believe in the name of the Son of God. So that you might, we went over this last week, you would kenosko in Greek, you would know, not wonder, you would know that you have everlasting life. Eternal. I wrote this so you would know. Because a lot of people struggle with knowing. This is a seasoned pastor. He knows people struggle with, what if I die? I don't know if I'll make it. He says, I wrote you this book so you'll know. And now I'm going to write to you so you can know how to get your prayers answered, because I got to hear this one over and over. After 50 years of, you know, being a pastor, he probably heard this a few times. Like me, I'm only 35 plus years in ministry. Trust me, it's enough years to hear this one over and over. How come you get your prayers answered? I don't. Have you tried this? Let's ask for his will. Now, I asked you all last week to do this for me just for a week. In any petition you make to God, say, God, here's my request. I put it before you, but not my will, but whose will? Your will be done. And did anyone try this week to see if it worked? How were your answers? Not good, she said. Got a no? That is good. A no or a delay or... Listen, as an earthly parent, there are certain things that I have to delay the answers to my kids. You know, they want the answer right then, and I'm like, they're not ready. Or there's other things they have to learn first. And so sometimes we're the same way. We just have to respect that God knows that. And he might say... I was taught really simply by our youth leader. When you pray, God has three answers. Yes, no, and my least favorite one, wait. Why did he have to teach us that? Because there is a verse in the Bible that says, wait on the Lord, right? You say that wait upon the Lord. What's it say in Isaiah 40, verse 31? They that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary, right? They will walk and not faint. I mean, it's a beautiful verse. Except we hate waiting, or I do. Anyone here like waiting? You're a good waiter. Americans are typically very poor in this area. We just don't do waiting well. We want instant gratification. We want it our way, right away. And if we don't get it our way right away, we want it free. I remember that as a kid. McDonald's taught me that. The French fries. They had a whole campaign when I was a kid. If they didn't get your fries out to you in 2 minutes, then it was free. And we used to wait until there was a rush. Little kids, we'd go in the mall there in Phoenix, and there's a little mall called Thomas Mall. We used to go, and there's fountains. People threw little coins in. We'd fish them out. Then we'd go to McDonald's, and we'd stand there. We'd wait till they're really busy. We got a little stopwatch. The girls must have just cracked up watching us come. Here's your little boys with pocket change. We're going to get fries, and hopefully we get free fries, and we use this money to go to the arcade, you know? So we had our plan all figured out, and we wait till they get a big rush, and then we get in behind all the people, and we'd be like, we need our fries right now. Here's our change. And the girls would smile. We're timing you. And I could see that, you know, looking back, those girls were nice to us because some of them delayed the scooping of the fries or, you know, putting the basket down. They went real slow. Oh, I got to take care of this first. And, oops, your fries are, oh, here you go. And we got free fries. It was like victory. The only problem was that it taught me to become very impatient. If I don't get it my way right away, it's a bad thing. And that carries over, unfortunately, into our Christian spiritual experience. We start, like, dealing with our Heavenly Father like he's some quick takeout counter. We're supposed to put it in our order and get our order and get out. And the whole, you know, waiting part of the experience is lost. You know, it's a sad thing because sometimes the waiting part can make the time when you actually get the thing even better. If you can understand what I'm saying, like, there are just certain things in life that maybe you had to wait a long time to get it, but when you finally did you appreciate it? It's like, oh, it's so fulfilling. I've been waiting for this thing for a long time. And it's a sweet thing. When the Bible says when desire is realized, it is sweet to the soul. It's a sweet thing when that, you know, that thing you waited for. Maybe some of you are waiting for the right spouse. And when that day comes, you're like, oh. All the waiting kind of will evaporate, trust me. When that right person shows up, you'll be like, oh, it was worth it. But the waiting time when you're doing it stinks. It's bad. You're like, oh, I don't like waiting. I hate waiting. We're terrible waiters. Well, when we come to the Lord, we have to understand he's allowed to say no. Or he's allowed to say wait. And yes, he is allowed to say yes. Sometimes you get a few of those. And it's a wonderful thing. But there is one thing that John's going to go over that is not very preached in the... I don't know why. Preachers, some like to pick and choose parts of the Bible to preach on. I believe in teaching every chapter, every verse. Just keep working my way through. Some people go, you really got good material. I'm like, stick to the book, you know, which I think all pastors should do, but I don't know where they learned their sermon writing techniques. But if you stick to the book, you cover all the topics. I mean, you cover all the times that it talks about grace. And how many times do you think that comes up? Grace, mercy, God's love. You know, is that like a theme in this book at all? It's like on every page. How many times do you think it comes up to give your tithes? Do you guys know that one? I promise, I teach on tithing every time it comes up. Because some people say, I've been coming here for years, I didn't even know you had a tithe box. I said, that's okay. God lets people give who he gives it, puts it in their heart to give freely. Because that's what it teaches in the Word, that let him who gives, let him give with a cheerful heart, because they want to, not under compulsion. There's nothing worse than someone being forced to give what they don't want to give. It ruins the gift. And I promise, I will preach on it every time. It just doesn't come up very much. So if you want it in the proportions it's delivered, that's what I'm going to do. I'll just teach you it like it is. In this next part, though, there is one thing. John is going to give the one exception of what not to pray for. It's shocking because everyone's like, oh, I get all my, now you taught me the secret how to get all my answered prayers 100% guaranteed. And I said, yeah, but I got to finish the chapter. Because he's going to say there's one thing don't pray for. There's one thing that you can pray all you want with the whole 100% technique, and you still ain't going to get the answer. And some people aren't aware of this. So let me show you what he says. He's going to end this whole book with the idea of, I'm writing so you know you have everlasting life. I'm writing so you know how to get your prayers answered. And I'm writing you also to tell you to watch out for idols. Because sometimes idols can pull our heart away from. What's the first commandment? I am a jealous God, he says, and thou shalt have no other gods before me. And the second commandment, thou shalt make no graven images, no idols, anything formed down. Don't worship any other gods. Just stick to me. Now, why does he want us to stick to him? Because the false ones are going to get you in trouble. And he loves you. He's like guarding you. It's not because he's uptight. And it's not like he's like threatened by the fact that other you know, teachers and religions come up with, well, we have this God or that God. I think God Almighty just sits up there and chuckles. Yeah, that's funny. You know, because when you look at God Almighty who can do everything, and then their God can only be in charge of water or fire or, you know, with the Asian influence, the kids do the firebender, waterbender, all these different things. And they're like, wouldn't that be a cool power? I said, that's nothing. Our God does fire, water, air, the whole thing, earth. Everything's in his power. Why just have a God that can only do one part? You're getting gypped. Someone is gypping you, getting you to trade in the Almighty for an imitation in a very limited form. Don't go for it. Now, John must have come across this in his travels, this part he's about to say. He says, there's one thing that when you see this happen, he says, don't bother praying for this thing. Because, and I have a feeling he probably tried it. I'm just guessing. I don't know. But he seemed to know this one will not work. So if you want, this is like a time saver. Don't pray for this particular thing right here. Look at this thing. He says, if anyone sees his brother committing a sin, not leading to death, okay, then it says he shall ask and God will for him give life to those who commit sin not leading to death. So you see your brother in sin, then you ask God, help him out of that. God says, no problem. That's no problem. But here's the exception, the next verse. But there is one sin leading to death, he says. One sin. Do you guys know the unforgivable sin? There's one sin, he says, this sin you don't even pray for. And someone said it. Apostasy. Blasphemy of what? Of the Holy Spirit. He says, don't even bother. If they blaspheme the Holy Spirit. Now, this might sound funny to you, but I'll try to help give you some understanding about this. Because he says, there is a sin leading to death. I do not say that he should make requests for this. Don't do it. He says, all unrighteousness is sin. And there is a sin not leading to death. But we know that no one who's born of God sins. But he who's born of God keeps him. And the evil one does not touch him. We know that we are of God and that the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we might know him who is true. And in his Son, Jesus Christ, he says, this is the true God and eternal life. Here's the Son. Jesus said, I just came to do what my Father commanded. And his commandment is eternal life. He said, give him eternal life. Okay, I'm going, Dad. Comes down here to give us eternal life. My Father commanded, I give you guys eternal life. That's my edict from my Heavenly Father. He comes down and they said, what are you here for? I didn't come to, what do you say? I didn't come to condemn the world. I came to save it. He didn't say I came here to condemn people. I came to save them. But there was one sin leading, it says, to death. And John was aware of it. He doesn't gloss over it like it doesn't exist. He just points it out. And I'm really glad he did, because before I was a Christian, I've shared my testimony before, but before I started following the Lord, I checked out a whole bunch of other religions. And during my high school days, I got in with a group of Satanists. And by the way, they teach that Jesus died. They say they killed him. And that Satan won. You know, that whole spiritual light versus darkness battle was Satan's victory at the cross. And even in the Satanic Bible, they talk about the crucifixion of Jesus. They just leave out that one little thing that happened 3 days later. Not in the Satanic Bible. I tell you, I read. It's not there. They don't. What part do they leave out? That he rose. Kind of a big deal. They gloss over that one. And they, you know, my friends, no, I don't share my testimony in detail a lot, because years ago I used to just tell people all the stuff that went on when I was with my Satanist buddies, and then people would tell me that they couldn't sleep for weeks and I gave them nightmares, and I'm like, that was just my life. I was the one that didn't sleep and had nightmares. Only they weren't when I was asleep, they were while I was awake. I saw stuff that just is not worth repeating. The Bible says, let your mind dwell on what's good, not on what's evil. So I don't want to share those things with you, but I will tell you that on multiple occasions when some of my possessed friends, and by the way, possession, I'm talking about in the using the biblical term of someone opening up their body to be a host for a fallen angel or a demon, it's called in the Bible. And they actually allow that demonic spirit inside them. And when they do that, they have some angelic powers endued to them. And by the way, demons will show off some of those powers just to entice you to their whole spiel is, hey, if we can get you to think this is cool, maybe we could get a friend for you. We've got a little fallen angel friend for you that will live inside you and give you powers. Now remember, everything the devil does, he's not an originator. He's an imitator. Because does God have a spirit to live that lives? We sang a hymn about it today. That what spirit lives inside us as Christians that guides us and leads us and comforts us? The Holy Spirit of God. Satan goes, I don't really want you to have that because I want to be in charge. So why don't you just take one of my fallen angels, one of my cronies, and let him live inside you. And he'll take over and he'll give you powers and you'll be able to do supernatural feats of strength. And he promises a lot of stuff, especially to young men that appeals to their fleshly urges. You just accept this demon but they never call it a demon. It's just a friend, a friendly spirit that will live inside you. And you're going to get all the chicks you want. You're going to get all the cars you want. You can have all this, anything in this materialistic realm, they promise that you will get. They don't always deliver, but Satan is the father of all lies, so lying is not anything excluded from his wheelhouse. When I became a Christian, I said, if I'm going to do this God thing, I'm going to need all the help I can get, because my Satanist buddies have demons inside them. And they don't play fair. And I realized that. I thought, if I'm going to do this Jesus thing, I need you know, being raised Catholic, we did Father, Son, Holy Ghost, right? Made the sign of the cross like this. So I knew that this whole thing, this is like package deal. Sign me up, but give me everything God has on his side, because those guys got some powers that they're not playing fair, and we need to have the power from God so that we can triumph over that. So I'll take the whole package, please. Holy Ghost and everything. And I remember when I received the Lord, as soon as I did, I got a phone call, and one of my satanic buddies went from his nice, natural voice to all of a sudden that demonic voice coming out of his mouth. And the demon starts telling me, it's not too late. You can come back, you know, and we have a friend for you. Come back, come back. And I won't do it in the voice that he does, because it's really creepy. And it's why I don't watch horror flicks, because some of them, I think they really got demon-possessed people to do the acting. You know, some of the stuff I've seen, I'm like, I saw that in real life. I don't need to see it in a movie. But they're saying, come back, come back. We have a friend. And Satan will try to entice people to follow him with all of these false promises. He's just saying, I'll deliver this, I'll get you that, I'll do this. And it sounds good. And of all the conversations I had, and I hate to tell you this, but I actually would sit down with people that were possessed and sit there and talk to their demons. And their mouth would be sitting there open without their lips moving or their tongue and just a voice coming out of the belly up like a pipe out of their out of this. And I would talk to them and say, you know, you should, I'm a good Catholic boy, I was altar boy, you should go to the priest and visit the box, you know, confessional. And you should tell him you're sorry. I'm telling the demon, not the guy who has the demon. I'm telling the demon itself that's inside the guy, you should go and tell God you're sorry, and you'll have to do a bunch of Hail Marys and a bunch of Our Fathers and, you know, penance, prayers, and probably light a few candles and stuff because you're pretty bad. And you're going to, you know, and I'm like, I'm playing, like, I'm good Catholic kid. Here's the prescription. And you know what? I think this is the only time that a demon ever spoke a truthful word to me. Because this happened on multiple occasions with different guys with different demons. When I would tell them, you should repent. Tell God you're sorry. Do you know what? They all, this is the only thing they all agreed on and answered the same. Do you know what their answers were? They said, we can't. We made our choice. We knew what we were doing. You don't understand. We want you to join us. We can't come join you. We did something, and this was hard for me to fathom. I'm like, but everything we do, we're allowed to go to God and ask forgiveness, right? And they're going, we can't. This fallen spirit, this angel, has done something that God says, there's no coming back from this. Did the angels, when they rebel, it says a third of the host of heaven followed Lucifer out of heaven. The Bible tells us that. Did they know what they were doing?
Yeah.
Yes. They were, and Satan said something. We read it written for us in the book of Isaiah. He says, I will make my throne to be like, whose throne? Yours. I'll be, whose job did he want? God's. God goes, mm-mm, you're out. And that was the day what Satan and the angels that rebelled with him, a third of the host of heaven, rebelled and walked out. Now here I am talking to one of the guys that fell out of heaven, and I'm telling him, you just got to go back and tell God you're sorry. And he's going, you don't understand. And I didn't. I didn't know the Bible well. I knew what little bit I knew from catechism, and I didn't know this verse. Did anyone know this verse that there's one sin you don't get to come back from? In fact, Jesus talks about it in the Gospel of Matthew. It's called the blaspheming of the Holy Ghost. And let me do out of Mark's Gospel. It's recorded in a couple of them, but Mark 3 is a real easy one for me. Jesus is speaking. And he says to the guys, he says, truly I say to you, all sin shall be forgiven the sons of men. And whatever blasphemies they utter, it says, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit, he says he never has forgiveness, but he is guilty of eternal sin. Anyone read that verse before or heard that? There's one sin you're not allowed to do, blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. So someone says to me, well, what's blaspheming? Best way to give you an understanding is just take the scripture. Remember in Matthew 9, when the Jews, Jesus was speaking to the Jews, and he was trying to tell them, look, before Abraham was, I am. And it says they took up stones to stone him, you know, like, what are you saying? Before Abraham, what, are you greater than our forefathers? You know, I am. Only God used that lingo in the Old Testament. When Moses said, who do I say sent me? And God answered, say, I am that I am has sent you. I'm the guy in charge. I'm the one that sent you. Well, in Matthew chapter 9, Jesus, Jesus is there, and he tells them to the crowd, to his disciples, get in the boat and go over to the other side. And in this passage, they brought him a paralytic. In verse 2, and he's lying on a bed. And Jesus saw their faith. I mean, they carried this guy all the way out to him. And so Jesus said to him, take courage, son. Your sins are forgiven. And they went, some of the scribes says, this fellow's blaspheming. Who is he to forgive sins? You know, to Jesus. Because who does the Bible teach is the one who has authority to forgive sins? Only God. Only God can forgive sins. So he's blaspheming. He's making himself out to be God. Now, if they knew what the angel said when he was born, behold, Emmanuel, which is Greek for God, what? With us. The angel going, good news today. A child has been born, and you shall call his name Emmanuel, which means it answers all the questions your friends have said. If God is real, why doesn't he come down here and show himself? He did. That's Jesus. He came down. And when Jesus did things that only God was supposed to do, the Jews even recognized, wait a minute, you're making yourself out to be equal to God. Jesus just said over in Mark's gospel, if you blaspheme anything, even against the Son of Man, it'll be forgiven you. You can blaspheme against him. But you can't blaspheme against one person. Who is that? The Holy Spirit. You can't say, I am an equal to the Holy Ghost of God. I am as great as God's spirit. Soon as your spirit tries to pull that maneuver, you just did the old satanic maneuver, Lucifer's maneuver, we'll call it. The one he did when he said, I'll be God. God doesn't get to be God. I'm a spirit. Angels, by definition, are ministering spirits. I'm a spirit, and my spirit's as great as his spirit. I want to be in charge. God goes, nope. Doesn't work. See, angels were made by who? By God. And the thing made doesn't get to say to the maker, I'm big as you. I'm better than you. That's foolishness. The creator is always greater than the creation, right? If it isn't that way, you have a runaway cyborg in a sci-fi show, right? That outgrew the creator, and they make themes like that, like it's somehow possible. It isn't possible in the spiritual realm with God. He is the only great spirit. His spirit is above all our spirits. It is called the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. And we, if we want to say, and there, John must have run into some guy who said, my spirit's as great as God's spirit. But I'm better. Worship me. Do we have any of those gurus running around today? Some of those false teachers that say their spirit is greater than God? Yeah. And they make up weird religions. And the weirdest part is they get people to follow them. Have you seen that? They get groupies, you know? And they follow them, and you're just going, oh, somebody forgot to tell them. Don't do that. That's the one sin. That's like a big no-no. Don't go there. Is it bad for me to teach people this truth? No. Or am I looking out for them? It's a safeguard. I got to tell you, so you stay safe in your spiritual life. Don't ever fall for any teaching that tries to persuade you that your spirit is as great as God's spirit. Or you're greater. Oh, there's the danger. As soon as you do that, you blaspheme. You went into an arena where you don't go. And I'd rather be the truthful preacher that says, don't do it. Like, you know, that's off limits. Any other sins we do, those are forgivable. That one, leave it alone. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't think God's mean because he says, don't touch that. You know, it's like, here's a button that blows up a nuclear bomb. Don't touch, written all around it. Do not touch, you know. Do not turn key. Is there something wired in some of us where we still go? It's like, do not walk on the grass. Why do they plant grass seeds and put little, that little yellow tape with the little sticks, and they put the little sign, do not walk here? And what do people do? I mean, there's a perfectly good sidewalk here. But they put that banner there, and it's like saying, come on, walk on me. There's little grass seedlings trying to grow. Just stomp them. I mean, we would never admit it, right? It's only part of our nature. When someone says, don't do it, we're like, oh, yeah? Am I supposed to step over that? Oh, yeah, watch that. See, I did it, you know? We just do it. It's like part of our rebellious nature. But if someone says, do not do this or it will cost you your eternal salvation, then we go, maybe we'll pass on that one. We'll step on the grass over there, not that. See, if I teach it to you right, you're going to know that's the one you don't do. And John, wise pastor that he is at this point, is saying, and don't even pray for the guys, which I was praying for demons to repent. Demons, not the people that had the demons, the actual demon inside the person. And the demon's telling me, it won't work. The one time I think that demon was truthful looking back, it's going, sorry, we knew what we were doing. It doesn't work like that. He didn't pray. I'm like, well, I'll do some prayers for you. And you pray too. And he's going, it won't work. It won't work. Why? Because they blasphemed the Holy Spirit of God. When those angels walked out, they knew what they were doing. And it was unforgivable. And some people come to me and say, Pastor, I think maybe I blasphemed the Holy Ghost. I'm really worried. I don't want to lose my salvation. I like what Pastor Chuck Smith taught me years ago. He said, when they come to your office and they ask that, you know what the answer is, right? Did they blaspheme the Holy Ghost? Absolutely not. You say, how do you know? I said, because you wouldn't even, Chuck said, you wouldn't even be in my office if you blasphemed the Holy Ghost, wanting forgiveness, because you wouldn't care. You just wouldn't. To a person who still has a heart where they go, no, I want my salvation. You didn't blaspheme. Don't worry. You might have sinned in other ways. Okay, we do that. But am I allowed to pray for someone in sin? Yes, absolutely. I just don't pray for the one who did this particular sin, because I'm just wasting my time, and God's sparing me the heartache of praying something that's not going to yield an answer. You will never get that one answer. You can pray all you want for a demon to be converted back to an angel of light that follows God, and guess what? Not going to happen. They made their choice. So John just puts it in there. He ends this. I love this. He's ending the thing with, well, we know the Son of God has come to give us understanding so that we might know him who is true. This is all part of us just growing in our understanding about the spiritual things. And we know in him who is true, and in his Son, Jesus Christ, he says, this is the true God and the eternal life. Now, little children, he ends this book with a real simple line. Little children, guard yourself from what? From idols. You could do a whole sermon on that one in American culture. I mean, we got idols in every kind of form and packaging. And I mean, we make cars into idols. We make Hollywood movie stars into idols. We make, well, we pretty much can gussy up anything and make it an, can't we? We can pretty much take any particular, it can even be our hobbies. You know, some people, they get so into I don't want to say this is not my wife. I was going to say, you can do swimming like my wife does, and it can become your idol, but she doesn't really idolize it, but she does it. It helps keep her even, she says, you know, and it keeps her sane. But can you take it to an extreme where it becomes your idol, you know, where it's more important to you than God? Anything, by the way, that is more important to you than our Heavenly Father just became an idol in your life. And so John ends his letter with, guard yourself from idols. Guard yourself. You know, if you know you're kind of predisposed to going after something maybe in an unhealthy manner too much, so much that you don't even consider the Lord anymore because it consumes you, you just found an area that's become an idol. And John would say, guard yourself from that. He doesn't want you to get tripped up. I mean, there's nothing worse for a heartache for a pastor than people you love and you want them to do well, and then you see them get caught in something and then it sucks them down. And you care because you care for the... Jesus tells pastors, you love me, pastors? Well, then take care of the sheep. Love the sheep. Tend the sheep. Look after them. There's nothing worse than seeing a sheep that's getting itself into a bad way because of a bad decision. It brings heartache. I know John had been pastoring long enough to see some heartache. So he just ends with this simple edict. Just guard yourself. Be on your guard. You know, and this week, it wouldn't hurt us at all to watch out for anything that becomes more important to us than God himself. If there's anything in your life that becomes so important that's the first thing you wake up to think about, that's the last thing you go to bed thinking about, and somehow God got edged out of that spot. Because the Bible says the first thing you should do when you wake in the morning is think about who? God. When you go to sleep at night, who do you say your night prayers to? To God. You know, just keep it in balance. But if it starts to where you're going to bed thinking about something else and you're waking up thinking about that thing and you're spending all day pursuing that thing just became an idol. It's more important to you than God. Take that thing and say, God, help me. I don't want that to come before you. You're first, not that. And you spiritually will become a much healthier person in your Christian faith. Your life will change when you allow God to help you. Because sometimes we don't even realize, we just get kind of OCD about something. We're just driven into it, and we just keep going and going and going, and God's going, who? That's consuming you. And whether you know it or not, people around you look at you like, whoa, check him out. It's getting a little weird. I mean, it's only comic books every day. I know some guys that comic books are their idol. I mean, they're more important than God, way more important. I'm blown away that some guy know every comic book character, all the issues, all the details of the story. They know the stories of comic books better than most Christians know the Bible stories. I mean, they can tell you every little detail. And I'm like, so how's your walk with God? Oh, what walk? I used to go to church, but now I read my comics. So you replaced your Bible with comic strips? Not good for your theology. And certainly not. You just swapped that. You got an idol. We need to put the Bible back in your hand. Let me pry that comic away from you. Read this before you go to sleep. Read this when you wake up, because this will help you grow spiritually healthy. And I want you guys to succeed. I want you to grow in the Lord. And I really am excited, because I know some of you tried out this thing about praying to see if it will work. God, your will be done. This past week. And some of you are just hearing about this week. So if I could just ask for an extension, everybody, would you do this for me for one more week? Anything that you got a question about with God, just what are you going to do? When you pray, you say, here's my petition, but never here. I'm asking whose will? Not my will, but your will. And let him see what he does. Because some of you are, you don't even realize your will is, well, the Bible says our thoughts are below his thoughts. My highest thought is below his basest, lowest thought toward me. So I'm thinking, I got a great plan, God. If you could just make my life go this way and do this for me and do that. And God's going, but I had, that's like, whoa, that's sad. That's like below my lowest plan for you. I have way better. You wouldn't settle for that. We don't even realize we're settling. We're like little kids. Can I have this? Can I have this? Can I have this? And he's going, yeah, but I had something way better in mind. Even as parents, sometimes our kids are asking us for stuff and we're thinking, you don't get it. I had something way better. All right, go ahead. Do we let them have those things sometimes? Just because they're so bent on it and they don't really say, hey, Dad, I'd like to have this, but is there something better that you wanted me to have? I mean, we'd fall over in shock if our kids did that, right? Dad, could I have this? But, I mean, well, I would like... Maybe, if you think it's a good idea, well, unless you had something better. I mean, can you imagine our kids saying that to us? They'd be like, you want to know what I want to give you? Because do we actually have kids that come to us and ask that? Do kids come and say, I want what you want to give to me? No, I'm pretty sure they got a selfish nature that comes up and says, I want this, and I want this, and I want that, and this, and that, right? They've already got it figured out. And sometimes we're that way spiritually with God. He's our heavenly. This is Father's Day. But let's not be spiritual little brats on Father's Day. Let's be the ones that go to him and say, okay, God, I got some petitions for you, but not my will, but your will be done. I want to see what you're going to do this week. And let's look forward with anticipation to see, do you think God will answer prayers this week if we do this? I guarantee you, if you just say, God, your will be done, in whatever it is, relationships, maybe it's bills, maybe it's just something you're struggling with in your heart. If you just try this, just do this for me. Extend this praying his will thing for another week. I want to see what's going to happen with this whole group. Because I know some of you have been doing it. And I commend you. Keep it up. But I'd like to see what would happen if a whole, like collectively, a whole group of people did that. Do you think God could do some pretty powerful things with a group that did that? Like, as a whole, we all said, okay, God, your will be done in our lives. How could he use us all? Can you imagine the power that just that thought, just all of us being used together for whatever is his will is to do in this community? I think we would see some powerful things happen. And it would be simple. Just one little thing over here. Jimmy, I need you to get that tent for those guys. And this, you know, he orchestrates all these things because he's looking out for the whole group. He's looking out for the whole community. He's looking out for our whole island. There's people hurting in this island. I'm pretty sure you're aware of that, right? And I want to be used to see, I want to be a hand of his mercy to whoever he needs us to touch. But I know it doesn't happen if I don't, if I'm too busy doing my idolic, is that right? Is that a word? I made up a word. If I'm too busy following my idols instead of following him, I won't get used. So we'll end with that. Guard yourself from idols. Pray for his will. And don't pray for demons that have already rebelled. They're not getting back in the club. Don't waste your time. And tell your friends not to go there. If they think they want to, say, don't do it. That's the one unforgivable sin. And, you know, I really haven't run into too many men who say, my spirit is greater than God's spirit. But there are some hokey ones out there. You know, I'm not going to deny. There's probably some that John must have run into back then. And the weird thing is, like Jen said, they reproduce. You think, oh, we used to have some of those in Arizona when we were there in the ministry. We got to Hawaii and we're like, hey, where'd he come from? Like they reproduced and followed us, you know? There are still whacks and guys that don't follow the sweet truths in this book that we need. Let's pray. Lord, thanks so much for getting to look into your word today. I thank you for our new young man, Sean, over there that's helping with the youth group. I pray they were easy on him today as he's praying about coming to help us and be our youth leader. I give you thanks for that, Lord. I always am praying for more laborers to come help us in this white harvest. So, Lord, send the ones that you know can help us to be a light in this community. And, Lord, make us strong in the areas where we're weak. Lift us up, Lord, where we're hurting. Heal us and touch us with your grace and your merciful touch, Lord, that we could be all well before you. And we thank you, Lord, for this really fantastic epistle, Lord, of 1 John. Let it sink into our hearts, into our minds, and let these truths carry us forward in our walk with you. Ask it now in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. You know, at this time is when we usually sing a closing song. You guys want to do it?
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.